and welcome to a brand new episode of the podcast entitled Couch Potatoes Unite! Exclamation point, which is based on a blog of the same name because we have been building our own fuller house this whole time. Synergy! I am the blogger in question and the self-styled chief couch potato. My name is Kylie and I love TV. If you feel the same, keep listening and or checking out our website, couchpotatosunite.wordpress.com, as you're bound to find some common ground or something you like. For Couch Potatoes Unite, we're all about the wonders and unique long-form storytelling of the small screen. CPU hopes you've been following releases of brand new episodes of the podcast on Wednesdays, as well as new blog entries on some Tuesdays. And as always, we have several more new episodes on the way. Because the panelists and I live lives behind our podcast, the episodes are published once per week. Subscribe to the blog or the podcast via iTunes, Stitcher Radio, and via Google Play to stay on top of brand new episodes. Episodes already published discuss a variety of shows around the water cooler, including, but not limited to, Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt, Marvel Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., New Girl, The Vampire Diaries, The Originals, Orange is the New Black, Supernatural, Gotham, Once Upon a Time, The Good Place, Grace and Frankie, and the DC Television Universe, or Arrowverse, on the CW. Plus, new episodes are in the works, including Doctor Who, Game of Thrones, Stranger Things, American Horror Story, How to Get Away with Murder, A Series of Unfortunate Events, The X-Files, and the Marvel's Defenders panel will talk Season 2 of Jessica Jones. A final visit with our Broadchurch panel, I swear it's coming, to say goodbye to the mystery drama from across the pond. We'll be launching new panels covering iZombie, The Crown, Schitt's Creek, and Will and Grace. And because we look back at shows now past, we'll be looking back at one of our most popularly requested panels of all time, otherwise known as Friends, as well as a one-and-gone series called Battle Creek. By the way, did you know that CPU also, from time to time, goes live? We've been live from the Bunker, Comedy Outlet Mondays at Dog Story Theater, and Grand Rapids Comic Con. And we're planning more live appearances and other cool stuff, so make sure you like or follow us at our Facebook page, our Twitter at CPU Podcast, our Instagram at Couch Potatoes Unite, and or our Pinterest at CPU Podcast, or subscribe to the blog, our YouTube channel, our iTunes channel, our Stitcher Radio channel, or find us on Google Play. In the meantime, if you don't hear your show in this podcast format, fellow panelists and I still write reviews, and we always seek new panelists, so if you have any interest in joining the discussion, say hello by finding us at any of those outlets I've mentioned. At the very least, stop by and leave us a thumbs up, comment, or review. We like feedback! Just don't be too hoity-toity about it all, or we might have to encourage you to pin a red rose on your nose. Today's panelists are continuing our CPU series, focusing upon a friendly family who for generations has lived in a full and fuller house, first on ABC, and then on Netflix in a revival series event. If you've been following our series, you know that I'm not here to moderate. Rather, our frequentest panelist, Kristen, takes the moderating mic once again to talk season 3 of the revival series Fuller House, along with a smaller number of returning panelists, namely Andrew and Leslie, as former panelists have unfortunately jumped the shark, and no new panelists have volunteered to take their places. To that end, we have 3 openings on this panel, so if you'd like to join it, which you can also do via virtual means, contact us at our social media or via email. We'll provide that information at the end of the podcast. You might have heard Kristen's voice on at least most of our active panels. In fact, there's so many to list, so just check out our website and look for the list of all CPU panelists page, which would be brought up under the left dialog box floating in the header, the picture of the TV watchers on the couch. For now, and without further ado, I'd like to welcome back Kristen to the moderating microphone. Take it away, Kristen!
Hey, thanks, Kylie! Like Kylie said, a smaller group of Fuller House enthusiasts have once again gathered around the iconic checked blue and white living room couch to talk season 3 of Fuller House, which is a Netflix original series that premiered the first 9 episodes of season 3 on September 22nd, 2017, which is also, not coincidentally, the 30th anniversary of the premiere of the original Full House, and the second 9 episodes were also released on December 22nd, 2017. And because this is a Netflix original, it is only legally available to watch on Netflix. We talk so much Netflix, they should give us free subscriptions already. So, Fuller House. Like Kylie said, it is a continuation of the same family-friendly favorite series, Full House, which originally aired on ABC from 1987 to 1995. This new series, which is set 20-some-odd years after the end of the original, it centers around DJ Tanner Fuller, reprised by Candace Cameron Bure, a veterinarian and widowed mother to 3 sons, Jackson, Max, and Tommy Jr., played by Michael Campion, Elias Harger, and Dashiell and Fox Mezzett, respectively. The Tanner house is full once again as DJ's sister Stephanie, played by Jodie Sweetin, her best friend Kimmy Gibbler, Andrea Barber, as well as Kimmy's daughter Ramona, played by newcomer Sony Nicole Burgess, have all moved in to help raise the boys, with Kimmy's on-again, off-again, on-again husband Fernando, played by Juan Pablo de Pace, and younger brother Jimmy Gibbler, played by Adam Hagenbush, who is also Stephanie's boyfriend in this revival, living next door in the former Gibbler home. And as always, this season features many special guest appearances from a lot of the original cast members. So this first half of season 3 finds the Fullers enjoying some summer fun, as what it was titled, including family get-togethers, some new teenage romances, and as well as getting ready for the wedding of Steve, Scott Winger, and CJ, not DJ, CJ, played by Virginia Williams, in Japan. The second half of the season, we see Jackson and Ramona navigating their first few months in high school, Stephanie finally embarking on her journey to motherhood, and DJ and Steve rekindling their relationship. Sorry, spoiler. Today, we brought back the a lot smaller Fuller House panel to discuss season 3, and I know they're ready to get started just as much as I am. So, as always, it should be noted that all three of us have viewed season 3 of Fuller House in its entirety, and we will be discussing sensitive plot points, including the one I just revealed. So, for those who haven't watched this most recent season of Fuller House, listen at your own risk, as there will be major spoilers. Hi, panel. Welcome back.
Hello.
Hello. Are you guys ready to talk season 3?
I'm so ready.
Let's do it.
All right. So, as Kylie mentioned, we did have two wonderful panelists, Amie and Jenn, jump the shark, but we are still here and we are ready to go. So, without further ado, we're just going to jump right in. So, I'd like you guys to introduce yourselves by your first name only. Then I'm also going to need you to rate your interest in the show as of the end of season 3. Now, some of these character descriptions have changed a little. So, are you watching Fuller House because you absolutely love it, you've always wanted to be a part of the Tanner family, and now you practically are, like Kimmy Gibbler? You love the original, and while the show may have faltered for a while, it's back and better than ever, like Steve. Good or bad, you're committed to the Tanners and Fullers for life, like Stephanie and her boyfriend Jimmy. Or is your relationship status with the show a little complicated? You can't decide if you like it or not, if you're meant to be together or not, and when you think you have your mind made up, you end up changing it again, like DJ. Or, you know, growing up in this show, you may have had some rough spots along the way, but just like your new extended family, the show will always be there to help you through it, like Ramona. Or is it trying too hard to be something it's not every once in a while, and it can be kind of painful to watch at times, like Jackson? Or is your relationship with this show possibly doomed, like Romeo and Juliet? And only time will tell if you will keep watching, like Max and his relationship with Rose. Are you just here for the cameos, like Danny, Jesse, Joey, and Becky? Or you didn't watch season 3 at all because you're not living in San Francisco, like Michelle, or you're not old enough to really watch TV yet, like Tommy. So who would like to start?
Hi, I'm Leslie.
Hi, Leslie.
Hello.
Welcome back.
Thank you. Good to be here. I think after watching season 3, I tried really, really hard the first two to be like all in and loved it. And they'll always have a special place in my heart. But I gotta say, I think with this season, I'm a Jackson. I think it was trying too hard to be something it's not. And it was a little painful to watch. As hard as it is to say that, yeah, I think that's kind of where I'm at after watching.
Yeah, because I think in our past two season talks, you were pretty in love with the show.
I'll always love them. But I tried to give it, like I said, an honest go. But yeah, this season was a little painful.
A little painful.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, welcome back, Leslie. Thanks for coming back and joining us.
Of course.
Hello, everyone. I'm Andrew.
Hi, Andrew. Welcome back.
Thank you. I will say, I feel like I usually choose two. Mostly Max. My relationship with this show might be doomed, like Romeo and Juliet or Max and Rose.
Mm-hmm.
But I also am a little Jackson. I think the wording in that is spot on. It's trying too hard to be something it's mm-hmm. not, and it can be painful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Exactly. I'd say, part one was more painful than part two.
I agree. We'll get into that too. I want to talk about how they separated the season later on. And once again, I'm Kristen. Normally I'm a panelist. Today I'm the moderator. And I'm going to kind of echo Leslie and Andrew. I think my relationship with this show might be doomed. It's, but it is painful to watch. So I kind of wrote the updates for Jackson and Max, kind of with the general feeling of the panel in mind, especially since we did have two people jump ship. But it got painful. It was, like, cringeworthy at times, and I was talking with one of the panelists before we started recording, and even the notes I was taking, it just got sassier and more disgusted with, like, really? Like, we're doing this again?
Yeah.
You are really making her give up the Heimlich maneuver to a fish? Like,
yeah,
it's painful, and I don't know. We'll see what happens, but my relationship might be doomed. So since we're all kind of on the more pessimistic side of things here, the next question, it's kind of open-ended. What were some of your favorites and least favorite moments of season 3? So, do you guys want to start with the good or start with the bad?
I think we should start with the good. I mean,
I'll probably go quicker.
Yeah.
All right. Well, yes. Leslie, why don't you start us off? What was a favorite thing for you?
Well, I really liked the kids again. I think they're all really cute, but I especially liked Max. I will always be a big fan of Max. I just think that, what's his name that plays him again?
Elias Harger,
yes.
I believe.
I think
yes.
He's a fantastic little actor. I think he just cracks me up all the time. And I think the little scenes, because now that the baby Tommy is getting a little older, he was a little more interactive with everybody, and I think they did really have some genuinely cute moments with, you know, him and him with the dog and other stuff. But yeah, I think that was probably part of mostly my favorite. And I liked how they still kind of continued to focus for the most part on the kids and, you know, them growing up and kind of, you know, going into high school, becoming teenagers, that mm-hmm. sort of thing. So I kind of liked that part of it too, though. So.
Yeah, Max is always a scene stealer, I mm-hmm. feel. Like he gets some of the best lines in the show too.
He does.
Which is kind of fun. And
yeah,
he's...
And he can pull it off. Like,
he can.
He's so cute. You can't get mad at him if he says something, like, rude. You know what I mean? It's just, I love him. He's so cute. He's adorable, I thought.
So besides Max, what else did you guys like?
I'd say the best overall moments of the show dealt with Stephanie and the surrogacy.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
And it was the most real, and mm-hmm. it's like the one time they brought the show into 2018.
Yeah, they don't. No other shows out there are really dealing with that issue, it seems like.
Yeah.
It's not very common.
Yeah.
So it's kind of nice to approach it in a really respectful way.
I was kind of cheering that part of it because, I mean, as I mentioned before, I can't have kids. So for me, it was like, yes.
Like, you see representation.
Yes, exactly. It's like, finally, somebody that's like me that needs to find alternative ways to become a parent.
Mm-hmm.
And I really liked how supportive Jimmy was, too, because, you know, in last season, he was kind of this goofball kind of...
He's a Gibbler.
Yeah, he's a Gibbler, right. But I feel like in this season, like... He kind of grew up a little bit, and I thought it was really cool how important it was to him to be, quote-unquote, the baby daddy and really be there for Stephanie and, you know, make it work. So, yeah, I agree. I think that was definitely a highlight.
I think he's the only Gibbler on this series that doesn't get on my last nerve.
Yeah.
I feel like Jackson was probably my favorite. He's the one
really?
That
okay.
I felt that he was the one that I was least annoyed by. Max is great, but at times
he can
got annoying.
Yeah.
Yeah. Jackson scenes didn't bother me. I felt, you know, it was like what Full House was when it was dealing with kids going through adolescence.
Yeah.
What the show was.
Yeah. I agree. It's really hard to say what some of my favorite parts are. I feel like they're all like really minor little things, but I think, and we're going to probably talk about this more later, I think my favorite part was that, spoiler, Vicky is back.
Oh,
even though
yes.
we don't know how long she's back for. For those who watched the original series but need a refresher, Vicky was the woman that Danny was supposed to marry through season 5. She was part of the famous They're Going to Disney World episode. She was a co-worker while Becky was on maternity leave. And I always really liked Vicky a lot.
Me
I
too.
Hated that she left. And so just having her come back for just a little cameo was awesome.
I think I literally squealed. Like, I was watching the show and they said that he got divorced and they had his bride for him. And so he goes away and she's there. And it was like, oh, yay, she's back. Like,
it
made me happy. Just
yeah,
even if it doesn't turn into anything, just the fact mm-hmm. that she was there was just like, yes, awesome.
So it was the most exciting cameo comeback.
For sure.
Of the
I agree.
Past
yeah,
I
for
agree.
Sure.
Yeah.
I think, because I think a big reason for that is because I think when you watch the original series, you're really rooting for them and you want to see them together, and then to see that they don't
mm-hmm.
get together kind of makes you, like, kind of sad and down. And so I think to see, like, oh, maybe she'll come back and they can have a second chance. And
And I was actually kind of surprised when they announced that the season was coming back and that Danny was going to be married. I thought, oh, perfect, that he got married to Vicky some way, mm-hmm. somehow. And then we see this random woman named Terry for 2 seconds.
Oh, yeah.
And then she's never seen again.
Yeah, she was in, like, what, one episode?
Just the pilot for a split second. And then it was always, oh, she's off with her family. Or I think this season he said she was on a yoga retreat or something.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, I was like, wait, no, but Vicky, like, he loved Vicky. He can't marry Terry. We don't know her. There's no connection to her.
Right.
So the fact that, you know, again, she may be sticking around for season 4. We don't know. Nothing's been released yet, but
I'm crossing
that
my fingers.
That was kind of fun. Yeah.
I'm sure she'll have another cameo.
I sure hope
I doubt she'll be, like, a recurring role.
I can't
imagine.
Yeah.
But maybe?
Did she do a lot of acting, you know, after she left Full House? I don't remember seeing her in anything else.
I don't believe so, but I'm not sure. Yeah. I don't recall seeing her in much of anything afterward, but.
Mm-hmm. Switching topics a little bit here. One of my other favorite parts was the Japan trip itself, not the getting there and what happened, but like the kids out in Japan, almost completely
really
unsupervised
cool.
for the day before, you know, the day of the wedding. I thought that was really neat with Ramona falling in love with this Japanese pop star, mm-hmm. and when Max and Rose and Fernando, of all people, went to Hello Kitty Land or whatever it's called.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know. That was a really fun moment, and that episode with them out on the adventure, that kind of reminded me of the classic, like, the ABC shows when every show would go to Disney World or Disneyland for an episode or two, or when Full House went to Hawaii back in the day.
Yeah.
It kind of reminded me of those, like, those staple episodes that every show had when we were growing up. So that was kind of, that was a highlight for me.
Yeah, I thought that was awesome, especially going international. I think that was really cool, especially because I think it kind of just, Japanese culture is so awesome. And anyway, I think to bring that into the show was really a good idea. And I really liked, I didn't necessarily like all the plot points that happened there, but
it was fun. I mean, they even did, like, the opening credits in Japanese, and the song was the Japanese version, and I don't know. I just thought they did a lot of really nice little nods for that episode, too.
Yeah.
Jumping back, she hasn't been in anything.
She hasn't?
Blossom and Doogie Howser.
Really? Okay, so kind of all, like, early...
Touched by an Angel.
Early 90s kind of stuff.
Oh,
so maybe she's...
Had to look it up.
So what's her name again? Is it... It's
Gail?
Gail.
Edwards.
Okay. All right, so
Gail
maybe...
Gail Edwards. Shout out, Gail.
Yeah, we love you, Gail. Please come back for more episodes.
Yep.
Yeah, so maybe she's ready to kind of jump back into acting a little bit. She's,
I could see it.
She's been gone for a while.
I think she's still, and I gotta say, just... on a woman basis, she looks great.
I know.
As
she
well, by the way.
Fantastic.
Like, I remember growing up watching her on the show and just being so jealous of her just gorgeous red hair, red curly hair, and just...
And it's nice that it's still, she still has that, like, 90s curl perm.
Yeah.
She's still rocking the curls.
Yes.
And that was kind of neat.
Yeah.
So was that everything that you guys kind of liked about season 3? Like, do you want to jump to what you didn't like? Is that going to be a longer list?
I feel like there were more things that I liked. Mm-hmm. I couldn't pinpoint what. But there are moments that,
I agree. There were moments, but there wasn't a solid episode.
It wasn't like a consistent thing. Yeah.
I
totally agree. I found myself watching and being like, oh, okay, this moment's cute, but in the context of the whole season, it didn't really add up to much.
So then what were some of your, like, most cringeworthy, painful moments?
Anytime Fernando was on screen. I mean, or the three of them together. Kimmy, the daughter.
The three.
The Gibblers.
Gibblers,
I don't know why.
They're
just really
so like so Fernando, we've said he moves next door to the Gibbler house, and he builds Ramona he kind of gets a bedroom all set up for her, and there's, at the push of a button, her bedroom converts into a dance studio
and
with
a frozen
ball,
yogurt
and
stand,
and
every teenager has a frozen yogurt
and there's
stand
bubbles
in their bedroom.
And then Kimmy gives her a dancing pony, and then the four of them, including the horse, go and have a dance party in her room. Yeah. So
I was a little bit like, really? Okay.
Yeah.
So we're doing this? Like,
yep.
I mean, I get the whole, we're separated, we want, you know.
Well,
the whole classic struggle of I want my child to love me more, so I'm going to trying to one-up the other parent with the gifts, like, that's fine, yeah. But did you have... I feel like they took it a little too far, almost.
Yeah. Well,
you know what I mean? Like,
Kenny and Fernando's relationship is where it's like, I don't know if
they're on
again.
I didn't either. But I was confused, too.
He's living next door. Like, I don't quite...
I don't understand it either. It's like a weird relationship to mm-hmm. me that I don't get it. I don't get if they're there, if they're together, if they're not, are they getting married again, are they not, because...
I wouldn't mind her leaving him in season four.
Yeah. Yeah, I think he's still considered a series regular, so I think he's kind of sticking around unless things change.
Yeah.
One thing that I really hated throughout this whole season was the really, really bad CGI.
Yes! Oh, thank you for
bringing that up. There was, you know, the koi fish at the wedding, which we'll talk about, but just the CGI on that fish was horrible. It was just horrific.
Awful.
There was parts with, you know, I think it was towards the end of that episode where DJ, Stephanie, and Kimmy were walking down a pretty much deserted street in Tokyo that you could tell was done in front of a green screen. That was really bad.
Mm-hmm.
And then within this horrible cringe-worthy scene of DJ and Matt being trapped in their veterinary office because somebody randomly dropped off an alligator.
Yeah.
Like, the alligator even was CGI'd at certain points. Like, they shot them separately and, like,
mm-hmm.
that was even done really bad. It's man, Netflix, you're putting a ton of money into this show because you're pumping out seasons like there's no tomorrow.
Yeah.
But are they? Is that why? Are they working for nothing?
I don't know.
It's just so cheap? That's what I assume.
I don't know. Maybe. It's an easy book. They can't throw a couple, like, extra 20s at the CGI guy to make it look a little better.
Yeah.
But I don't know.
Yeah. I remember watching the koi fish part and I was like, oh, ouch. Like, you couldn't...
That whole thing was just...
Yeah.
That whole wedding episode itself was ridiculous
and
cliche and...
Yes.
Pain.
But it was also such classic Full House.
Yeah.
You
it
know?
Was. Yeah.
But, I mean,
but it's classic,
it was still
but it's, like,
cheesy.
Turned up.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. Like, I don't remember the original being that bad.
It was the 90s, and we were younger.
Yeah.
But
that could be it, too, but I just feel like, really? Like,
TV was less provocative, so we were, you know,
that's true.
I don't know. I mean, I will say, I feel like I said this during season one or two, but I wish they would have taken the route, and they wouldn't have. But I wish they took the route of, like, the Brady Bunch movies, where it's like they can be as cheesy as all get out, but they're like stuck in the real world, so they're like crazy to everyone else. You know,
yeah,
and if they
really
like poke fun at themselves
yeah.
and allow themselves to be a little more provocative.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Yeah.
It needed to
yeah.
come to 2018 and it
mm-hmm.
stayed in 1992.
Yeah. Well, at least, yeah, I will say at least one of the benefits of the season, there was no awkward call out to Michelle or the Olsen twins in the season. There was like no mention of her, and there was no like, hey, come join us, Mary Kate and Ashley, or you know,
that's
they
true.
Didn't actually do that. And like, thank goodness it took them two seasons to figure it out that was not a good joke.
Yeah, that's not,
but they did, and I was really happy. I was nervous towards the end, like, hey, we're getting to the end of the season, they haven't really made an awkward joke call out about it, is it coming? It's not. They didn't do it. I think I was more excited about that than anything else. That
yeah,
this season
I kind of was expecting for them to do something like that again, and I was glad they didn't, because, yeah, the first couple of seasons it was really bad, and I just, yeah, I'm glad they kind of put that to the side.
Yeah.
So.
I agree. Seems like there was a little less fan service this season, too.
Yeah.
Which is what I've been wanting since season one. I hated how they were, like, pandering to us a little bit. It just, like, let the show do what it's gonna do and stop being weird.
Talking more about what we didn't like, I was kind of trying, what did you guys think about Joey's
kids
storyline? Because I feel like, okay, we get it, your kids are awful, you don't need to. I feel like they just stretched it out and kind of,
well, it was their fault for making that a storyline and making the kids so obnoxious in the first place.
Anytime
you have Joey, it has to be brought up now.
Yeah, he has these four horrible kids that even he doesn't like half the time. And, you know, and I think I was more concerned about, well, was it Ginger is the wife's name?
Probably.
Played by Laura Bell Bundy. I'm like, where's Laura Bell Bundy? I want to see Laura Bell Bundy.
Yeah.
Where is she?
Yeah.
No. Oh, she's going to be in Vegas for 6 months doing a magic act? And
yeah.
Okay. I was more disappointed that I didn't get to see her.
Mm-hmm.
But I also hate the kids.
Yeah.
They really could have done a better job. Because I don't see Joey as being a bad parent.
Yeah.
And raising kids like that. Because he did a good job
yeah.
with the girls in the original series.
Yeah. Yeah.
It just, I don't know. It doesn't make sense, and it's a shame, because yeah. I like Joey, but I don't want to see his kids.
Yeah.
No. I think that was kind of a one-joke thing, like, oh, ha, 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 look, he has these...
They're crazy.
Crazy kids, okay. But they... I just feel like they just beat it to death.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I... Okay, we get it. You don't need to shove it down our throat, you know?
Yeah.
And I feel like that... Just from my opinion, that I felt like that's kind of what they did.
Mm-hmm.
To a certain extent.
Well, looking back over the season, there wasn't a ton of, like, big plot points to discuss, but I do have a couple here I would like to get your kind of thoughts on.
Okay.
One of the first big things to happen in this season is that we finally, after 30 years, we get to see what the inside of the Gibbler house looks like.
I don't even remember that.
It was, like, one of the first few episodes. So Fernando and Jimmy, Kimmy's younger brother, have moved in and purchased the Gibbler home, and they have restored it to its former creepy childhood glory of when Kimmy and Jimmy were younger.
Mm-hmm.
And so they invite everybody, the main characters, over for dinner to see the restored Gibbler home. You know, there's a clown doorbell that plays this really creepy carnival tune. The inside of the house is like a mirror image of the Tanner/Fuller house.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the entrance is on the right side of the screen instead of the left. So everything is mirrored, which makes it look weird in itself. But, like, everything is decorated like it's a Twister game board.
Mm-hmm.
There's, like, blue, yellow, red, and green, like, circles everywhere. There's a Velcro wall, which is how they used to discipline Kimmy and Jimmy.
Yeah.
They would leave them on the Velcro wall.
I must have not watched this episode.
Maybe not.
Because none of it is
coming back. Yeah, like Kimmy was talking about, like, there was a ghost that lived in the house. There was a creepy organ, and like a chandelier fell on them during dinner. Yeah, it was awkward and way outrageous.
Yeah, I thought so too.
I would almost have found it funnier if the house was just, like, really normal and just they were weird.
Yeah.
You know, but, I mean, she even mentioned, too, like, her parents haven't lived in the house since the Y2K thing. Like, they moved to a bunker in the Everglades and have never left.
Yeah.
That was her explanation for where her parents went and why they sold the house. Yeah. That's
what
she said. Yeah. Yeah, before Y2K, they moved to a bunker in the Everglades. I don't know. It was a really weird throwaway line, but...
Yeah. It didn't seem like the house that you would... picture for the Gibbler. I mean, I knew it would probably be crazy, but I thought it would be more of like, oh, we're really eccentric, so we have these really eccentric
things,
bottles,
like, not
all over the house.
Not
but
like
not
carnival.
Like a
carnival.
Yeah.
It was a carnival.
Yeah. I didn't expect a clown doorbell and a Velcro wall and just all these weird things in the house, and I'm like, okay, I guess that's how they want to go, but it wasn't what I would have pictured.
No. We got to talk about the wedding episode in Japan,
because
that's what everything has been leading up to these past, I don't know how many ever years. But so quick synopsis, the whole gang is going to go to Japan for the wedding of Steve and CJ, because CJ's stepfather is Japanese. He's called the Dragon. He's alluded to be some kind of Japanese mob boss,
mm-hmm.
I think. So he's going to pay for the whole thing. So that's why it's in Japan. So they go, but you know, all throughout, I don't know, since the series started, DJ and Steve have been kind of making flirty eyes at each other and having these moments, and even though they're dating other people. And that continues to happen. So on the plane to Japan, DJ unknowingly admits to Steve, because she thinks that he was Kimmy, who was initially sitting next to her on the plane, that she has feelings for Steve, and watching this wedding would be like her losing her soulmate. Oh man, what's Steve going to do with this information, because he's getting married in 36 hours.
Right.
And then also on that plane, Matt, DJ's boyfriend at the time, takes a moment to talk to Stephanie and say he was going to propose to DJ in Japan. They get to Japan, and Matt proposes, Steve sees, everybody keeps it a secret. They get to the altar, and guess what? Steve and CJ don't get married because Steve admits he has feelings for DJ. Sort of. And then when there's no wedding, Matt tries to fix the situation by saying that he and DJ should get married right then and there in front of a bunch of strangers that they don't know or that they're not related to, and DJ breaks up with Matt.
Yeah.
So now DJ and Steve know that they're both having feelings for each other. They're both single. Woohoo. And then there's the whole business with the koi fish.
Yeah.
Where DJ accidentally flings Steve's wedding ring into the koi pond. A big, gigantic koi fish who's 100 years old swallows it, and she decides to dive into the koi pond after it to give the fish the Heimlich to spit it out. So that's Japan in a nutshell. Talk about it. I want your uncensored opinions of this train wreck.
It was a train wreck. That's a perfect description, because the whole time I'm like, it just was so predictable. Like, when she was pulling the ring off of
it's a tiny little tight.
I was like, okay, that's gonna fling over into the thing. Oh, of course the fish ate it. Oh, of course she's gonna go in after it.
Oh,
of
Steve
course
goes
she's
in
gonna
with
get
it.
The fish timeline.
And Steve goes in after her.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Like, it just, I knew before they did it what was gonna happen. It was like, okay, obviously the wedding's not gonna, just even leading up to that scene, it was like, okay, wedding's not gonna happen. They're gonna get back together.
It was predictable.
Yeah, and it wasn't like any, what would have been more surprising for me would have been something like
her choosing Matt.
Yeah, her
yeah, that would have been the only way to save that situation.
And
you know,
yeah, and I just was like, yeah, okay. Like, it just, I think because it was so predictable, it didn't really have the emotional impact that I think they wanted it to have. I mean, yeah, okay, I will admit a part of me was like, oh good, they're back together, like, well, yeah. DJ and Steve forever.
We've been wanting them together
right.
since 1993,
right.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it's like, okay, that's how you're going to do it? That's a little, it just felt so predictable and cheesy and hokey. Like, there's got to be a better way.
I mean, and there was all this lead up even prior to that episode with, they had a karaoke party and DJ and Steve sang Summer Nights from Greece like they used to in high school, supposedly.
Mm-hmm.
And they were, you know, then Matt and CJ got jealous. Oh no. And then DJ unknowingly tries on CJ's wedding dress at the bridal store where Steve happens to be trying on his tux, and then they get their picture taken together. And CJ walks in and sees them.
Yeah.
And, you know, DJ in her wedding dress, so now she has to go buy a different one. There was all this, of course.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, there was no surprise. There was no emotional response. It was just, you could have avoided all of this.
It was like you had a crystal ball and you could look into it and be like, yep, I know exactly what's going to happen. Boom. And sure enough, it did.
Mm-hmm.
So, like I said, yeah, I think the emotional impact that they wanted was kind of not there because of that. And like Andrew said, I think I would have been more surprised
if
and a little more connected with it, if she had been like, oh yeah, Matt, I'm marrying right now, or whatever, if something different had happened, because, you know, obviously we want them back again, obviously they're gonna, you know, it just was leading up to that. You could see it a mile away.
We knew from day one that she would choose Steve over Matt.
Mm-hmm.
And since day one, I was hoping she'd choose Matt, because that
That's
relationship
unexpected.
And right.
Yeah.
That relationship didn't annoy me. I don't know. It's just so predictable. As has been said, I think it would have been a lot. They could have done a lot more things if she did choose Matt. Maybe Steve is in love with DJ, so he loses CJ, but she realizes that, you know, she loves Matt. That could have caused some good conflict.
Mm-hmm.
That might have been interesting. And I feel like with these shows, when two people are like, are they going to get together? Are they going to be apart? I feel like it never works when they stay together. It's
because
you know,
they build up that will they, won't they. It's
right.
The Ross and Rachel. Will
yes,
they, won't they.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I mean, it seems, you know, like you said, Andrew, like you knew since day one, this is where it was going to go. And
yeah,
I mean, as soon as they announced before season one that Steve was coming back, yeah, they're not going to bring him back for them just to be friends.
Yeah.
You know, that's not going to work. I mean, she ends up with Steve at the end of the season before the show got canceled. He comes back and takes her to her senior prom.
Mm.
You know, it's just,
but
it's
like
one of
that,
those, like,
senior prom, I mean,
I know, but it's
20
the whole
years have passed.
I know, but still, it's that, you're just, that's just, that's DJ and Steve. That's,
yeah.
It's like Corey and Topanga. That's just how it's gonna go.
Yeah, like, we all knew they
were
gonna.
Corey and Topanga.
I like Corey and Topanga. Well, a couple goals. Right
yeah.
There. Yeah, but then, so DJ and Steve get back together, and they agree to wait a month out of respect before they start dating. So, the month passes, And they're just about to leave to go on their third first date, was what the family decided is what it was. And unfortunately, then a horrible dense fog sets over San Francisco as Steve has arrived to pick up DJ. And oh no, the whole Tanner family, Danny, Jesse, Becky, Joey, are all in the house too. Oh no, they can't go out to eat. What are they going to do? They're going to have a super awkward date in the Tanner living room with the whole family helping out and watching from the sidelines.
Yeah.
As you do.
As
that
you
was
do.
Super awkward.
With the fake mustaches.
Yeah. And it looked to me like they were having issues with that mustache when I was watching it. Like, he could not keep it on.
It was just one of the cheap ones, so they kept sticking it on everybody as they made an entrance. That was the running
yeah.
gag.
Yeah,
they
yeah.
could only find one mustache in their costume box, and they just shared yeah. that all the time. I don't know. It was... Yeah, fish sticks over mac and cheese and boxed wine, and...
Yeah.
Where did they get all the decorations, too? I mean, they're all stuck in the house.
Too.
They have beautiful...
Kimmy.
Net.
That's what she does.
Oh, true. It's all from Kimmy. It's
well,
just,
yeah.
She's hanging all in the garage, yes. right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know, but that...
At the Gibbler house. I mean...
Yeah. Gibbler style. Party planning. Oh, man. Yeah, that date was cringeworthy. It's like, again, I'm happy that they're back together.
Mm-hmm.
For nostalgia
well,
purposes,
and like,
but really?
Yeah, and the other part that I thought was weird was the whole calendar thing of the countdown leading up to
with
the
With Steve with food?
Yes! I was like, really? That's
Yeah,
so
3 days
weird.
To go, he's holding up 3 bananas. 2 days to go, he's holding up 2 coconuts.
And then...
And it's taken... The pictures were also taken in the Tanner kitchen.
Yeah.
In front of
the fridge. To match
the
refrigerator. Yeah, it was...
Really? I thought they were going to see each other for a month, and yet you snuck in to do a photo shoot to
yeah.
turn into a ripoff camp? Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know.
In his defense, he did always come over to raid the
and,
fridge
and
yeah.
eat
all the
Oh,
fridge.
That's true.
He's all food-centric. I'm really surprised he's not like a gastroenterologist that he's a dietist.
I know, right?
It's like, why didn't he become like a digestive system doctor? I don't know. Oh, Steve. Oh, Steve. All right, well, let's jump to something a little more positive. Well, Andrew had kind of touched on it that, you know, Stephanie's journey to being a mother through surrogacy was kind of one of the more real moments of this season.
Mm-hmm.
And so throughout the journey, Becky, who Stephanie confided in during season 2, has made an appointment for Stephanie to go see a really big hotshot fertility doctor. Thank you. There we go.
There you
in
go.
In San Francisco.
Yeah.
And this doctor tells Stephanie that there is a chance. She has some viable eggs left that they can try to make happen. And she does get 3 viable embryos out of them with the help of Jimmy, who says he wants to be her baby daddy. And so along their process to finding a surrogate, they settle on Kimmy.
Because
mm-hmm. why wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Why wouldn't you settle on Kimmy Gibbler, who's going to be close to 40 as well? She's the same age as DJ, and DJ just turned 40.
Yep.
You know, so usually that's not the age for a typical surrogate, but I get where they're going for the comedy factor for next season. So what do you think about their journey and ending up with Kimmy?
I thought it was really cute. I thought, I thought Jimmy showed a lot more maturity and being like, no, I want to do this with you. I want to prove to you that
I'm committed.
Worthy and committed. Yeah, and I thought it was really sweet how committed he was to it. And you could obviously see that. That definitely came across. And I'm, you know, happy for Stephanie. Again, as a woman that can't have kids, just the fact that they're addressing this issue of, yeah, there are a lot of women out there who cannot have kids, and nowadays there are many non-traditional ways to become a parent. You can do your surrogacy, you can do adoption, you can do any number of things. So I think just the fact that they're putting that in there and having that storyline, I think is huge. I think we wouldn't have seen that back when the show was originally on the mm-hmm. air. I don't know how I feel about Kimmy being the surrogate. I get, but like I said, I think I get where they're going.
That's the comedy
factor. For next
season,
for the comedy factor of it, yeah.
And not having to introduce another character, probably.
Yeah.
They could have tried to get Michelle.
Just saying.
Yeah,
and I mean, they could cast someone who looks like the Olsen sisters to play Michelle. And that would have been a cute way to bring that character in.
Yeah.
If they needed to.
Well, I think what I also really liked was how everybody rallied around Stephanie. It's like, no, we'll help you pay for it.
Yeah, the family's
whatever
all chipping
you need,
in.
We're chipping in. We're going to help you. you know, don't just say no because of the money. Otherwise, you know, we don't need to regret not taking doing. The chance.
Yeah, like what Becky had said, you know, it's
You
know, it's better to look back and say, I'm glad I tried than say, I wish I would have tried, right. Essentially.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. I think out of everything, very, you know, it's Kimmy. It's going to be really interesting. Her little mommy-to-be party with Stephanie was kind of fun and cute for a minute.
Yeah.
But I thought it was really sweet in this season finale as the whole family was at the 80s party at the recently repurchased Smash Club that is now a laundromat celebrating the 30th dad-iversary of Jesse and Joey moving in. The way that Kimmy announced it to Stephanie that she was actually pregnant.
Oh, yeah, I thought that was cute.
Kimmy had this really cute little 80s outfit on because that was the theme of the party. She opened her jacket, and there's a little sign that says, your baby on board.
Yeah.
And I thought that was a very sweet way to tell Stephanie and Jimmy and the whole Tanner Fuller clan that, it's happening. Stephanie's journey is going to start. And, they have said that season 4 is going to focus on that journey with Kimmy being pregnant and Stephanie nesting a little bit and all that.
I think it'll be interesting to see how that plays out and what they do with it. I think it'll be really, really cute. And I think it'll be fun to watch Stephanie and Kimmy's relationship kind of change as it goes along, too. Because I think even in this season, you kind of see them becoming a little more friendly with each other, a little less antagonistic.
Because they always were. There was even, I think, a mention of how Stephanie felt that she was always seen as the annoying little sister. And
I think it'll be nice to watch that kind of grow.
I have nothing to add.
No.
Okay.
I mean, probably the best storyline of season 3, so maybe that will make season 4 bearable?
Yeah.
Question mark,
we'll see. Then, so Andrew, since you didn't have anything really to say about the last point, I'll throw this one to you first. What do you think about, we didn't really get a lot of new characters this season, but one of the new characters we did get in the second half was Rocky, who is Gia's daughter, who's the same age as Jackson. And Gia, we kind of talked about her last season. She made a cameo back. She was a bad girl in Stephanie's class in high school who she smoked, she drank, she was a bad influence. And now her daughter Rocky is also said bad influence on Jackson. What'd you think of Rocky's introduction and her effect on things?
I didn't mind it. I thought as soon as she was on, it was obvious it was going to be Gia's daughter.
Yeah, see, I didn't think so right away. That kind of caught me by surprise, but then it made perfect sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, Gia's made cameos, and so I figured she'd be back, and she has been, and I don't mind her. I didn't mind it.
Yeah.
No, it was fun. And like I said earlier, you know, Jackson's storyline was kind of the more
traditional, full house style storyline.
Yeah,
dyeing his hair blue because Rocky has her hair dyed purple.
And yeah.
Dressing, you know, with the ripped jeans and the leather jacket and we're all.
Yeah.
Yeah, what did you think, Leslie?
I thought it was great. I thought the actress who played Rocky is really good. And I liked how Jackson kind of comes to realization that, you know what, I'm me, and if you can't accept me for who I am, then this isn't going to work. But I think I like how they're portraying Rocky, too, as a strong girl who's like, you know what? I don't need a man necessarily. I can take care of myself, which is, I think, interesting because I think girls around that age, just stereotypically, you think, oh, they're boy crazy, and all they talk about are boys and their hair and their makeup. But she's a little different.
She's more feminist, and she really comes across that.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
I think she even says at one point, I don't need a man to validate me.
And I was like, yeah, go, girl. I like that they kind of complement each other. Kind of in the series how they were talking about how Jackson was a good influence on Rocky because he was making her more responsible, doing her homework, going to bed
brushing
on time,
brush
her
teeth. Yeah.
And Rocky was kind of a good influence in that I think she kind of...
She helped Jackson learn to stand
Jackson
up for himself.
And kind of grow
some McNuggets, what she was saying.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, I thought it was interesting. I think Rocky, too, she's going to fill a void. This season, they kind of announced the departure of Lola, Ramona's best friend and Jackson's first girlfriend. Her dad supposedly got a job in Fresno, so she's left as of mid-season. So Rocky, I think, has been brought in to kind of be her replacement, and I think it's going to try to give a little more conflict, I think, and some more interesting storylines. So It'd be fun to see that. A fun little, not really little, kind of a gigantic Easter egg. In honor of the 30th anniversary of Full House, they arranged some filming at the actual house that was used for the original exterior shots. That house, we kind of talked about it a little bit in the last podcast. The creator of Full House and Fuller House, Jeff Franklin, actually purchased the Full House house back in 2016. And he was kind of restoring the outside to its Full House style glory, what it was in the late 80s. It had been, you know, repainted. Previous owners hated the fact that it was so recognizable, so they really changed the outside. Jeff Franklin restored it, and he said, you know, hey, maybe, you know, maybe for season three we'll shoot some scenes at the actual house. And they actually did. In one of the last episodes of season three, the show started by recreating the first scenes of the pilot with Jesse and Joey with their entrances. They recreated their lines. They were wearing similar clothing. Danny, quote-unquote, rented the iconic red convertible from the original credit, the title credits at the top of the show. And so the scene that they shot at the house was them all leaving through the iconic red front door, walking down the steps and getting into the convertible in their assigned seats and taking a spin around the city and doing the credits the way that they used to. I kind of thought that was kind of a fun moment. Did you guys kind of catch on and get the little nod?
Yeah, I thought it was really cute.
Was someone else in the car, though?
Kimmy, because Kimmy was never in the car.
Right.
Yeah,
so it was Jesse, Joey, Danny, and then DJ, Stephanie, and then Kimmy sat where Michelle's car seat was originally, in the middle and the back. So, yeah, so Becky stayed inside with Pamela since they weren't part of the first episode. Neither was Kimmy. Kimmy didn't come until episode two or three. She kind of made a reference to that, too, that she wasn't there right at the beginning.
Yeah, she did mention that, I remember.
Yeah, but it was kind of neat to see, man, they actually, like, blocked off that street in San Francisco for a couple of hours and filmed them in the car.
Yeah, I thought it was really cool. It kind of brought me back.
Again, this is all part of their 30th dadiversary celebration of the last episode. So with that last episode, we also learned that everybody's moving back to San Francisco from LA and Vegas. So Danny has been kicked off Wake Up USA. So he's unemployed and he'll be back, moved into his former master bedroom. So DJ and Stephanie are now going to bunk together like they used to. Danny's going to be in the master living with the girls. Yeah, we're getting some fun looks from... Kylie is still here, by the way. She's recording. She's just not speaking. So for those of you who can't see what's going on in the living room right now, Kylie's giving us like some what looks. Because it's very funny. So yeah. So that was kind of my expression too when Danny said he's going to move back into his old bedroom and the girls can bunk like they used to and whatnot. So the sleeping arrangements, I think, are going to be a little different in season four, which could be kind of fun too. You know, but then...
Who's in the basement?
Stephanie's in the basement right now. So DJ's in the master. She's in Danny's room. Kimmy is in the attic, which used to belong to Jesse and Becky and the boys. Ramona is in
Jesse's own room.
Jesse slash... Yeah.
Well, and Jesse Joey's.
Joey's old room. Tommy, the baby, is in Michelle's slash DJ's old room. It became DJ's room later on. And then Max and Jackson are in what was DJ and Stephanie's slash Stephanie Michelle's
bedroom.
So that's where, and then, because Joey did move down to the basement first, then they turned it into the recording studio and he moved back upstairs.
Yes.
Everybody moved around in this house, pretty much except for Danny. He stayed.
Why can't Ramona stay where Nikki and Alex stayed?
Because they made a little switcheroo in the layout of the attic. We noticed. We talked about that during season one.
That's right.
Because the twins did have a full-size bedroom in the attic.
Yeah.
But for this revival, instead of the twins' bedroom being on the left side of your screen, they moved it to the right side, and essentially it was a closet.
Yeah.
Which I think they did it for laughs because the twins were older at this point. But yeah, so they kind of essentially just demolished the twins' bedroom. Mm-hmm. But you know, what they could do though, Ramona could go live with Fernando next season. And then there's room for another single bedroom. So I don't know. We'll see. But, you know, there's a good possibility, too, that Jesse and Becky and Pamela may even move into the house temporarily while they're looking for a new place in San Francisco. Joey and, unfortunately, his four kids are moving in from Vegas because Ginger is out on a cruise. She's doing magic on a cruise. Yeah. That's why he's like.
So they're moving in the house too?
They might be, or they're everybody's at least. They said moving back to San Francisco. Danny is the only one confirmed to be moving back into the house. But
it gives me a headache, and I don't even live there.
I know, right? It's not that big of a house.
It's a fuller house, but it might be a little too full.
Yeah.
I don't know how they're going to address that. Or
yeah,
make it
I think
work,
like the tagline for either this season or like a teaser for next season when they announced it in January was "Life's about to get fuller," or "Life is a little fuller" or something. It's a play on the name, but yeah, it's gonna be interesting with everybody back. But that means logistically, all the adults will be able to make more cameos. Those are, like I said, all the big points we kind of hit on. All the other ones with Vicky coming back, Jesse and Joey repurchased the Smash Club, which has been turned into a laundromat, so they're going to restore it to its former glory because they paid cash for it, and instead of buying a new property, like Becky had said, why don't you just go buy a new club and name it the Smash Club? They're like, well, we already purchased this one in cash, so we're done. So they have to transform a laundromat back into the Smash Club. But we saw the Rippers come back.
Yep.
For the little party. We saw Vicky come back. Grandpa Nick came back.
Yeah.
Because I think, is that Jesse's?
Jesse's dad.
That's Jesse's dad.
Yeah.
Yeah, so Grandpa Nick came to watch Tommy while the family went to Japan, so that I couldn't place him for a minute. Like, I know I've seen Grandpa Nick before.
Mm-hmm.
I don't
remember
where.
Yeah, I thought that was so...
That was very sweet.
Yeah, I thought that was so sweet.
Yeah.
It was nice to see him back, because I always liked him in the original show, so...
So is there anything else you want to talk about as far as, like, the plot points of season three? Anything else you're dying to say?
I guess for me, it was just... They had a lot of musical numbers this season that I thought were really
They opened the season with a musical number, and I almost turned it right off.
I did, too. It was so annoying. And they were like, and Stephanie keeps singing a bunch of songs. And not that she's not good.
No, everybody keeps singing a lot.
But, yeah, everybody's
and they're all auto-tuned, and it sounds horrible.
Yeah, exactly. And I was like, why do we need all these? It's not a musical. Like, why are we
singing all the time
and dancing and
so?
Yeah.
Would you like to see less singing?
Yeah.
Yes.
Me too.
I wanted to see less singing on the original series. I mean,
yeah. Oh, speaking of singing in the original series, did you guys catch the Easter egg of when the gang first actually landed in Japan?
Yeah.
Of Jesse selling Forever cologne in Japan. Just to remind the listener, in the original series, Jesse and the Rippers, their hit song Forever, their ballad, became a huge hit in Japan. Mm-hmm. And so the fact that he's selling cologne called Forever in Japan was kind of a nod. And yeah, Ramona did some dancing, and then she didn't do some dancing, and so there was that. But otherwise, it was just kind of, it was cute, it was painful.
Yeah, it was.
We'll see what happens.
Yeah.
So, we're going to get into a little more technical stuff here real quick. What did you guys think about Netflix releasing the season in two parts? Having the first half released in September and the second half, which started with the wedding in December. Did you guys mind it? Did you like it? Did you hate it?
I didn't mind it. I'd say I probably liked it. I mean, that just meant there were more episodes to watch.
Mm-hmm. Because they did. They increased the episode count from 13 to 18. So we had 9 and 9.
But it made it easier to get through, and then I could take time off. Yeah. And, I mean, this was a show that I would watch while doing other things, like laundry or dishes, you know? It was my housework, or to fall asleep to at night. So I think some episodes I didn't watch because Netflix just played through them after I already passed out.
So that's how you missed the Gibbler house.
Yeah, I think so. So
but
I'd
you
say
still,
I,
but you still followed along. And it worked. Yeah.
So I'd say I liked it.
Yeah,
I think it
worked because I think with the two-parter episode, I think with breaking it up like that, it made it a bit more of a cliffhanger.
Yeah, because what they did, the season break, the last episode, so the ninth episode, was them getting on the plane to go to Japan. DJ spilled the beans to Steve. Oh no, there's turbulence. It's going to be a bumpy ride, said the flight attendant. Boom, cut off.
Yep.
Then they open the second part of everybody landing in Tokyo and going from there to the wedding. Yeah, I see, Andrew, I wasn't smart like you. I binged this whole season in 2 days. I don't recommend it to anyone. It was painful. It was so painful, you don't know how painful it was. So next time, if Fuller House does this again, which I don't think they will, but if they do, I will watch it. in at least have some separation between them.
You don't think they will? You think they'll go back to like 13?
I think, well, the next season, I think they are dropping it back down to 13. Okay. I don't know if that's official yet. We'll talk about that in a second. But I think the reason that they released it in two parts was because they wanted to make that September 22nd release date, which was the 30th anniversary of the Full House pilot airing. And so I think they didn't have all, they knew they weren't going to have all the episodes ready to go. So they kind of did it in mind, I think, well, maybe they were writing and filming of, okay, well, let's get these first nine out and done. We'll release it on that date. Then we'll get the back nine done.
So they were originally going to be releasing 18 at once?
I think that was their plan.
Okay.
Because they knew their target release date was going to be the 22nd of September. They knew that months and months and months before.
Yeah.
And so I think they just, that's how they could kind of drum up some buzz of, we're going to hit the 30th anniversary and we're only releasing nine. Ha, see in a couple months for number two.
I wouldn't mind if Kimmy Schmidt did that to give more episodes.
Yeah.
Just saying.
Mm-hmm. Release the season in two parts.
Yeah, to give more episodes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So speaking of more episodes, did you think the higher episode count, did it help this season or did it hurt this season?
I want to say it probably helped this season. Because I feel like the good storylines and where they're structuring the show to go would have been rushed if they only did it, you know, the wedding, the...
Yeah, they would have rushed Stephanie's storyline.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
I agree. I think the longer season helped it so that they could kind of stretch it out and give each plot point its proper
time and
attention and everything. So, yeah, I think it worked. It was...
That could be the reason why we got so many musical number fillers. Like,
could be.
Just padding.
Yeah, that could be too.
So in which case, I changed my mind.
Yeah. Yeah. You just want them to use their time effectively and not musically.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. It's
or
not
Fernando.
A musical show. We're not
just kill Fernando off. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I will say one other cringeworthy moment that reminded me. Frank Smith, who was Fernando's 4th of July alter ego.
Oh, yeah. That
was
so
from
annoying.
The deep south of Texas. So done. So done.
Yeah.
No, no Frank Smith, please. So we got a little controversy to talk about now. So in March of 2018. In March, Netflix announced that it had fired Full House and Fuller House creator and showrunner Jeff Franklin over complaints of poor behavior in the writer's room and on the set. There was reports that he was verbally abusing staffers, making inappropriate sexual comments, and even bringing his latest sexual conquests to the set and offering them small parts in the show, which didn't sit well with a lot of people. During the original series run, Franklin left the show on his own accord after season 5 and said that after his departure, quote, really weird stuff started to happen after I left, and all those little decisions, such as ending Danny and Vicky's relationship in season 6, contributed to the show's early demise in 1995. And that was Franklin in an interview that he had with TV Line earlier this year. So a few weeks ago, Netflix finally named his successors to carry on the Fuller House torch, which will be Steve Baldakowski and Brian Behar, who have been co-executive producers of Fuller House since day one. But they weren't on the original Full House, but they've been with this new series since its inception. Knowing that the showrunners have changed, and the original guy is out once again, and knowing what happened when he left last time, do you think that this will be a change for the better? Or do you think this means that Fuller House's days are numbered?
I'm not sure, but I would hope that it means brighter days are ahead. I think as an actor, if you're working in an environment like that where you're getting yelled at and there's all this sexual stuff going on, especially now in this time of
with the Me Too movement
times up and we're not going to tolerate that anymore, which I think is awesome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because he wasn't doing anything to like the cast or
right,
but he was just making inappropriate comments and being verbally abusive,
right? And I think if you're doing that and you're making people uncomfortable and making it a hostile work environment, I think that's going to affect the product that you put out. And I think if they can get these two new guys in there and create a more positive work atmosphere, I think that'll hopefully make it a more positive show and a bit of a better show. Because I think as we've talked about here, there wasn't really too much to like about this season. So it kind of makes me a little hopeful.
So,
like, okay, maybe if we get new...
Yeah, people
who've
been around, but who...
Right,
yeah.
they can kind of make changes here and there where it needs to be, maybe they can bump up the quality of the product a little better.
I mean, I think season 2 showed promise, and maybe that's because the bar was so low. And so now that we've, like, gone even lower, that no matter what, it'll be better.
It'll be better.
But, I mean, I'm not, I never watched Last Man Standing or Eight Simple Rules, so I couldn't tell you to how they work as showrunners.
Yeah, real quick. So, Baldakowski and Behar, the new showrunners, they have a history in television that spans decades. They've worked together on some and they've worked separately on others, but their resume includes shows such as Last Man Standing, Eight Simple Rules, The New Adventures of Old Christine, and many, many more. So they're not new to the comedy genre. They're not new to the family show kind of genre. But
I didn't know that. I think knowing that, I think, yeah, definitely. I think that'll definitely be a positive for the show and make the product a lot better.
Mm-hmm. Is this their first time show running?
They've been executive producers, and I don't know if they've been showrunners or not, but they have been executive producers on those shows, and they've been co-executive producers of Fuller House since day one. So they've been around. They've been in the writer's room. They know what jokes have worked with the audience. They know what hasn't. So maybe they're the ones responsible for the lack of Michelle Tanner call-outs this season. I will say that I'll be cautiously optimistic about this change. Sometimes, you know, maybe when you hold on too tight to something, you kind of don't see its faults. So maybe that's what Jeff Franklin was doing, was not really seeing the problems.
Yeah.
You know, being too close. And so maybe this, you know, these two guys, you know, they really have a heart for the show, and maybe they'll help it be better than it was.
Yeah.
And hopefully they'll make good changes and they won't recreate another Vicky and Danny breakup situation. Mm-hmm. I mean, at this point, you know, I don't think the only thing they could do to kind of kill it would be to make Steve and DJ break up again and be done. That would kind of kill it for me, I think. But
yeah, I think so too.
Not me.
Yeah, well, like you said, the bar's pretty low. It's pretty low, so there's only one place it can really go up.
What
here,
they should do is just watch Will and Grace and Roseanne to see how these reboots should be done.
Yes.
But even Will and Grace, I've never been a fan of Roseanne. I didn't watch the original. I'm not watching the reboot. But I am watching Will and Grace.
Mm.
Some episodes are better than others. But overall, it's pretty solid. But they're also doing it on short. I think it's only 13 episodes.
They keep raising them.
Do they keep raising it?
Yeah.
Excellent.
And Roseanne's obviously gonna too.
Roseanne's
like 18 million viewers.
Doing good. Yeah. I know they've had a stumble in one of the lines that they had in a recent episode, from what I understand. But other than that, I've heard that it's been doing pretty good.
I mean, Laurie Metcalf's one of the greatest actors working today.
Well, she is. Yeah, hands down. Hands down. I love her no matter what.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah. So maybe. Yeah, maybe we'll see things go for the better. So, on that note,
knock on wood.
On that note, what would you like to see happen in season 4, knowing where we ended in season 3 and knowing that new showrunners are coming in? What do you want to happen? What would make the show rewatchable? Not like you're going to go back and watch it again, but what's going to make you keep watching this show?
Yeah. I would definitely say this, keep going with the surrogacy plotline. Although, to me, I think I'm kind of a little afraid that they might take it and make it, like,
too comical?
Too comical and hokey, but hopefully they won't. And I obviously love to see more of the kids and their adventures. Like, I thought the thing this season, for example, with the, what do you call it, the wooden
the ancient mariner.
Classic Full House, and just the little hijinks that they get into like that, I always enjoy. So,
yes.
More of that, more of the cuteness of the kids. And
yeah, I agree. I did like the Ancient Mariner bit where they...
Yeah.
Short summary, someone bumped it, it broke, the face fell off, and so that way the parents wouldn't notice, each kid would take turns wearing a sea captain's hat and the fake beard and standing in for the face behind the rest of the statue. That's classic Full House.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it reminded me a lot of the old episodes.
What I would say is, you can keep the camp, but less of the caricatures, and it just gets way over the top. And if they just pull it back and are more real, it's like, I mean, Disney Channel shows aren't even this campy. I mean, they just need to pull it back. And if they are more human and like real people, then... Mm-hmm.
Yeah, DJ had a lot of campy moments this season that were really...
Yeah, like the whole
with her, like, thing. Or her trying to be sexy...
Oh my
with
gosh.
Matt, where she was just like,
yes, I wanted to bring that up. That was so weird for me because as it weirded me out so much because Candace Cameron Bure is such a conservative, like, modest Christian woman, at least from what I've seen.
That's an understatement, yes.
Yeah. I mean, I think she could, yeah. I mean, and so to watch her try to be, like, this sexy, like...
But she did it in a too comical way where I feel it's not true to DJ's character.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah. It's that kind of, like, that weird physical caricature humor that I agree, Andrew. I want to see less of that, hands down.
Yeah.
But also, on the flip side of Miss Candace Cameron Bure, she's also hawking her wine on this show, too, if you haven't seen that. There,
she's always the Bure. Had that big.
It's her private label. Her family owns a vineyard.
Oh, really?
Yeah. If you look, and whenever the girls are drinking wine, except for the boxed wine, the bottle they have out on the table is Bure wines.
I
caught that as I was watching it last night when I was finishing it up. And I actually paused it and I rewound it. I'm like, wait, did that say what I think it said?
Mm-hmm.
Bure wines. And I looked it up online and it's her family, her immediate family, her husband, her kids, and some of their close friends have the vineyard. And so product placement.
Sell it in the stores and stuff? Wow.
It's California wine.
Wow.
Yep. So she's, you know, but she is also a producer. Product placement.
Yes.
Yeah. So anything else you want to see happen in season 4? Any guesses as to what might happen? Any ideas?
There will probably be a scare of losing the baby, but then everything will be all fine because they wouldn't do that.
Yeah.
Hopefully, Danny's the only one that moves back into the house.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like to keep it somewhat believable.
Yeah.
And more of the new actors hired and less of them. Because
less
there's...
Fernando and
Gordon. Oh, no, straight, no. Because I was going to say, I mean, I like the new, like, you know, the new cast members, the kids, and like Matt stuff. I forgot about Fernando. But I mean, like, all the original Full House people, I feel like Stephanie and Aunt Becky are the ones that I tolerate the most.
They feel the most true to their... to the characters that, like, how we would see them grow.
Exactly.
Yeah, and I like little baby Pamela. I think her and Tommy have some cute cousin moments.
I think so, too. I thought they were really cute. And I kind of would like to see, too, maybe Stephanie and Jimmy kind of committing more, like, maybe getting engaged or something like that.
I was expecting that, and that
or maybe Vicky and Danny get engaged, and they have a double wedding.
Or how about Vicky just sticks around?
Right.
One thing that I could see happening in season 4 regarding Stephanie, Kimmy, Jimmy, the pregnancy with the babies. Stephanie and Jimmy had 3 viable embryos.
So maybe they'll have twins like Nikki
or
and Alex
triplets
were twins.
Because having 3 kids is the trend in the Tanner household. And how much fun would that be for comedy in season 5 to have them with 3 babies?
But since they do everything so... Everything in this show is like to a T of like how it was in Full House. That would it be twins to be like Nikki and Alex?
Maybe. Because supposedly Nikki and Alex are going to come back next season, in season 4. That's a rumor that they've been approached to potentially come back.
Like more? Because...
Just, they haven't been in since the pilot.
Yes, they have.
Have they? They weren't...
They were at the holiday.
Oh, that's right. The Thanksgiving holiday. So those are the only 2 times we've seen them, but they weren't in season 3 at all.
Oh, they weren't?
They were not.
I thought they were.
They didn't have any family gatherings because it went from June through, October? They didn't even make it to Halloween this year.
Yeah.
It was 4th of July?
They weren't there. Only Danny went for 4th of July. Okay. No, Danny and Becky and Jesse. So, but yeah, they didn't... It wasn't the big deal. So, but supposedly the actors for Nikki and Alex have been approached to make an appearance for season 4.
Nice.
So I could see twins, too. You might be onto something there. But I think it's going to be more than one baby. Because one baby isn't funny, but 2 babies can be funny with new parents.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think that something like that will probably...
Yeah.
Pop up.
And I think, Steve and DJ are going to be all cute and adorable. We're not going to see Michelle because that's not happening.
No.
Even though it's been kind of in a downward slide, will you still recommend Fuller House to others at this point?
I think it would depend on what you're looking for. If you're just looking to sit down and watch TV and just not think and just have something on in the background, like you were saying, if you're like, doing dishes or laundry, watch it, but sitting down and actually paying attention and getting it, probably not.
I think we're past that point. I mean, unless you've been living under a rock, I mean, if you want to watch Fuller House because you watched Full House, mm-hmm. you would have given it a try already. Yeah. So it's like, you know, when people, like, let's say on Facebook, are like, oh, I need recommendations for a show on Netflix to watch. No, it'll never come out. Like, Fuller House, watch it, you know? Mm-hmm. No, there's, like, 30 other shows on Netflix I would recommend
Same. I think it really is cashing in on all of the nostalgia mm-hmm. and the love that we have for the original. So yeah. I think unless you loved the original or you're just looking for something really stupid to just put on for a couple hours and not think and just...
Background noise.
Yep.
Yeah. Yep. Because like Andrew has proved, you don't need to watch every single episode to follow what's going on. Right. Which is what most half-hour comedies, you don't need to have watched every single one. It should be noted that Netflix has said that Fuller House is the second most binge-raced show that they have. Binged race means like somebody will sit and watch it within like it's like within a weekend or like they will finish it in a relatively short period of time.
Wow.
Fuller House is the second most, the first one being Gilmore Girls, A Year in the Life.
Huh.
So that's their Gilmore Girls, their little mini series is the most binged raced with Fuller House being its second.
I bet everything's or not everything sucks. That was good. End of the World or whatever that show was called. Mm-hmm. Is that
that's
right?
Probably up there. Yeah.
I think
that's
that probably replaced
I would recommend
that. I watched
that,
in one sitting.
I did too.
I've never done that with anything.
I've heard it.
That's really a good one too.
Yeah, but that one has a much more limited audience base, I think, just based on the title. Parents may not let their kids watch it. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, this one is rated like Y7, so it's 7 years old and up, so it's a wider audience base.
It could air on Nick Jr. Mm-hmm. Like,
it could have been. Yeah, it could be like, you know, yeah, Nickelodeon, early evening.
I mean, like...
But yeah, second most binged raced show in Netflix's history. That's kind of interesting.
Yeah, I would say if you're looking for it, watch the original show. It's always on anyway. It's on a Nickelodeon.
It's
on Hallmark Channel.
Fuller House is available in its entirety on Hulu, actually, right now. So if you
Fuller?
Want to, Full House, sorry. Oh,
Fuller.
Full House. Fuller. The original Full House is available in its entirety on Hulu. With Fuller House, the one we're talking about, is only available on Netflix since they produce it. Last question, are you going to keep watching? Or have you decided to jump the shark?
I'll keep watching just because I want to see what happens with the whole surrogacy thing. But beyond that, I think if they didn't have something like that to, like,
keep me,
I probably would jump the shark. But because they have that and it's...
Intrigue. It means something to you.
Yeah, exactly. I think I'll keep watching.
And I mean... Every time a season has been released, I mean, I've been a part of this panel, but I have been usually caught up with all my shows, It's like starting is like, okay, no big deal, you know? So as long as I'm caught up on everything else and it's on, I'll probably still put it on.
But it won't be a priority for
you. No. And I won't be like, oh, when's it going to be released? Mm-hmm. Like other shows, I'm like, you know, I have that in my calendar. Like it's being released on Netflix this day. So.
See, I would say I'm pretty close to Andrew. I mean, this was released in September and December and I didn't start watching it till April, what's today? The 5th. Today's April 5th. That's the date of this recording. I started watching it April 3rd. So, you know, probably won't make it a priority either. I'll probably check it out just to see, but if it's really bad, we may be doing a Jumping the Shark panel next. Who knows?
Yes.
We've already lost 2. We may lose 3. So,
no.
All right. So, with that, I would like to thank Andrew and Leslie for continuing to join me to talk about season 3 of Fuller House. If we decide to keep watching, this panel will reconvene after season 4 of Fuller House premieres on Netflix later this year, which has been confirmed. It will come out sometime in later 2018, but as of early April, nothing has been decided yet. And now that I have said this, Kylie will say that.
CPU is produced by Back Pocket Productions, run by yours truly, the Chief Couch Potato, and hails from Grand Rapids, Michigan. Please, if you like what you hear, take the time to rate us on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, or Google Play. That means give us stars, comments, reviews, let us know how we're doing. What do you like? What don't you like? What should we keep? What should we toss? You know what to do. If you have suggestions on shows we might consider, contact us at our website, couchpotatosunite.wordpress.com, via email at couchpotatosunitepodcast@gmail.com, or via Facebook and Twitter. P.S. If you want to join this panel, which as you can see might be in shark jumping territory. Or you can contact us on social media. Of course, we have new and old shows to chat about around the water cooler all the time. We have several more new episodes coming down the pike, as always. And if you miss old episodes or want to know in general what we cover, we're everywhere. Find us, search for us. We top the Google searches under our name. We're awesome. Subscribe at our website, our channels, our social media. Stay up on new events and episodes. As Kristen said, until next time, all available seasons of Fuller House are available to stream only on Netflix. Netflix, give us our subscriptions.
Pretty please. Pretty please.
Please sponsor us. In the meantime, the Fuller House series will come back after the release of the fourth season. As Kristen said, the date of which has not yet been announced. Keep a weathered ear to CPU for all the deets. In the meantime, and until next time, until next episode, new episodes are published every Wednesday. Keep listening, keep watching, stay tuned.
Bye!